So the district. So this graphic shows the eastern portion of our city. This is Nesbitt Ferry Road and this is Brumbelow Road. Nesbitt Ferry Road represents a city boundary between the two cities. Johns Creek has expressed an interest to improve this intersection. The way that we can do that is through a traffic signal. It does warrant for traffic signals. Johns Creek has expressed the interest, such a strong interest, that they are willing to pay for this improvement. And so they will be paying for the improvement of this intersection within the city limits of Roswell. We have stipulated in this intergovernmental agreement, basically it's a contract between us and our joint sister city on sort of the mechanics on how this will be done, the standards that we expect. Because at the end of the day, this improvement will reside within the city of Roswell. So we've discussed this at committee. I think you had a chance to review the IGA. I understand that the city of Johns Creek has already approved this IGA on their side, so they're waiting for us to approve it on our side. If you approve it tonight, I will notify them, and I expect that they will be interested in beginning the construction right now. So it involves Basically, this is just a concept. The concept involves a left turn lane from Nesbitt Ferry into Brumbelow, a left turn lane from Brumbelow into southbound Nesbitt Ferry, some other road improvements to improve the sight distance coming down here to the south. It'd be a mass arm intersection with a crosswalk. It's a fairly simple intersection improvement. And the city of Johns Creek and I discussed the concept of one day turning the city to a roundabout. We agreed that we would pursue a joint venture with Georgia Department of Transportation for a roundabout, but they did not want to wait for that process to go forward. They would like to see this intersection signalized as what we'll call an interim improvement until such time as we get funding, and then revert this signalized intersection into a roundabout. So I'm happy to answer any questions.
Does the council have any questions? Councilmember Price.
I know that the council approved this once before we entered into this arrangement. So what is different about this now compared to the previous one?
I'm not sure we had a memorandum of understanding at the time to come to council.
That's
at that point in time, it went to committee, but now we have a formal written agreement. That's probably the only significance.
That's correct. So this formalizes, we didn't have a formal agreement before.
Okay.
We just had a set of plans.
Okay, so is there anything in this that makes us think that we will not come to a better conclusion than the last time?
I'm very confident that if they honor the terms of the agreement, as we will honor the terms of the agreement, that the city of Roswell will both serve by this agreement.
We got their attention.
Okay, sounds great.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Do we have a motion? Motion for approval. Now, Councilmember Diamond, is there a second? Second by Councilmember Price. Does anyone in the audience have any questions or comments? Any further discussion by council? All in favor of the motion, raise their hands. That's Diamond, Dippolito, Eichelhardt, Price, and Orleans in favor, all opposed. Councilmember Wynn is abstaining, passes with 5 votes with 1 abstention. Thank you. Do we have a motion to approve the consent agenda? There's a motion for approval by Councilmember Wynn. Is there a second? Second by Councilmember Orleans. Anyone in the audience have any questions regarding the consent agenda? All in favor of the motion, raise your hand. Passes unanimously. We have a reappointments. Mr. Davidson, would you read the name of the folks we're looking for to be reappointed?
These are approval of reappointments to the following boards. Brian Chamberlain to the Planning Commission for 3 years. These are all 3 years, actually. Roberto Paredes to the Design Review Board. Judy Meir to the Historic Preservation Commission. Richard Holberg to the Historic Preservation Commission. Alex Paulson to the Historic Preservation Commission. Hayden Branch to the Board of Zoning Appeals, Glenn Baggiola to the Board of Zoning Appeals, and for a 4-year term, Dave Sheehan to the Downtown Development Fund.
Do I have a motion to approve that slate of appointment?
So moved.
Motion by Councilman Orleans. Councilmember Ross.
Was Judy
Mayer
included on that list?
Yes, ma'am, to a 3-year term to the Historic Preservation Commission.
Right, I didn't hear you say it, that's
fine. I have a motion to approve this slate. Is there a second? Second by Councilmember Diamond. Is anyone, any council members have any questions or discussion of this motion? All in favor of the motion, raise their hands. Passes unanimously. We have a Community Cultural Plan Steering Committee appointments. Councilmember Wynn, do you want to address that issue?
Yes, sir. Thank you so much. This is for the approval of the Community Cultural Planning Steering Committee appointments. This is going to be helping the cultural planning group to decide what we're going to do with our cultural arts in
Roswell.
And so.
Wait a minute, Councilmember Wood, that's admin, I apologize.
Oh, I'm sorry, well, I'm just following your.
I understand, that's my fault, and I.
That's how come I was stuttering a little bit here, because I didn't know what I was.
It is under Recreation Parks?
It's under admin.
It's under admin.
Wait a minute, let's have a ruling here.
Well.
I'll just keep on doing it if you want.
The project manager is being managed by Recreation and Parks, the project is being managed by Recreation and Parks.
That's down there.
The Roswell Arts Commission, the liaison is from the administration department, so it just depends on how you want to count the project.
Councilman Eichelhardt, are you prepared on this one?
I think so.
All right.
I was gonna go on with that.
Your liaison, so I'm going to refer to you.
Do a better job than I did.
I got confused.
Because as people out there, I know we all just switched liaison roles in the last week, and we're not really sure where we are, probably. And this one in particular has a little bit of everything. But as Councilmember Wood was saying, this is a new group that's going to be helping us on our cultural and arts, community cultural arts plans, and the steering committee is going to be working a lot. I just seen the schedule today. That was my one introduction to the group. So this is a large number of people from the community representing a wide range of activities and professions and interests. And do we need to, am I going to keep going or is somebody else going to say anything?
Do we have a slate of evaluations?
Should I run through?
Yes, please.
Okay. We have the the members, I won't go into everybody's affiliations, but those to be nominated are Rochelle Muchak, Larry Wiseman, Morgan Timmis, Lyon Mims, Sally Johnson, Deborah Ewing, Becky Hawkins, Aaron, I had this earlier today, Aaron Deere, Maura Brummer, Donna Smythe, Maggie Davis, Cheryl Small, Kendra Smith, Jasper Tanner, Kendra Cox, and myself as the council liaison. I was trying to remember what that abbreviation meant. RBC, okay, there you go. All right, so that is the nomination for the members for this.
Do we have a motion to approve those nominations?
One of the, thank you for seeing this, if you've ever heard. We have two alternates just in case some of them can't serve or something happens, and it's Trip Wiles and Michael Patton.
Do we have a motion to accept those nominations?
That is a motion.
That's a motion by Councilman Eichelhardt to accept those nominations. Second by Councilman Orleans. Any further questions or discussion by council? All in favor of the motion, raise their hands. Passes unanimously. This time we'll go to Councilmember Becky Wendt, Community Development Liaison, for her agenda.
We're right on this one. Okay, first one is approval of city sponsorship for the historic Roswell Criterium on Sunday, April 27, 2014, and this will be Alice Whitfield to present. Ms. Whitfield.
This is a request to approve the sponsorship for the Roswell Criterium on behalf of Bike Roswell. This matter was before the committee on January the 29th, at which time the committee agreed to move forward with sponsorship in the amount of $17,582. At the time, based on my math, I believe that we were within budget. However, after double checking that there is an amount of $1,458, which this is approved at this requested amount, we will be over budget. I'm asking this body to, if you want to approve the overage, we would ask that you approve a budget amendment for the general fund operating contingency to cover that cost. If not, you would be approving the sponsorship at $16,124.10.
Any questions? Do we have a motion?
Yes, Mr. Mayor. So we're looking at $1,458, am I correct?
Yes, ma'am, for this event.
Okay, then I'm going to make the motion for to approve the sponsorship in the amount of $17,582.17, bringing forward $1,458 out of our general fund budget to make up the deficit.
Motion by Councilmember Wynn. Approved for $17,000. Is there a second?
Second.
Councilmember Dippolito.
Just a clarification on the motion. It was the general fund operating contingency that we're moving.
Is that correct, Ms. Love?
Yes, it is.
In that case, I second.
Second by Councilmember Dippolito. Any questions by council or comments for open to the floor? Be brief, floor. Any comments from the floor? All in favor, any further discussion before we take a vote? All in favor of the motion, raise your hands. Passes unanimously. We'll hear briefly from Mike Roswell just to tell us the good things that are coming. So folks in the audience can hear the vision. You can take the picture now. But now comes the hard work.
You're right, Mr. Mayor. Good evening. Thank you all very much. We appreciate your support in committee the other day and again this evening. Mike Roswell has undertaken the criterion for the first time this year, and we couldn't do it without all of you. And like Mayor Wood said, now the hard work starts. We are now official, and we can start tomorrow morning looking for more sponsors, and we hope you will help us with that. The Roswell Criterium is a traditional bicycle race. We hope to grow it year by year into a huge Roswell Cycling Festival, which we can all be proud of. We can already be proud of the Criterium because it's the biggest one east of the Mississippi River in the United States. So just one more thing that we can be proud of in Roswell. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, Mike Roswell. Bicycle home now, or you can go to drive your car. It's a little safe now. It's a little safe after the car.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'm going to skip down to number six, which is the final plat. 201-40014-1580 Ohio Road, Roswell Manor from Alabama Holdings, LLC, Jim Jacoby, and lot 612.
Thank you very much. This is a final plat approval of the subdivision on Holy Alabama Road. This approval was originally for townhomes before the downturn in the economy. It is now being built as a new single-family home instead of having attached a breezeway between the final plat is in conformance with our requirements. The staff recommends approval.
Councilmember Gwynn.
Mr. Townsend, I do have one question. I have to refresh my memory on this one. They did private streets, they did build to our standards.
Correct.
Thank you. Mr. Mayor, I'd like to make a motion to approve this final plat.
Motion for approval of the final plat by Councilmember Wynn. Is there a second? Second by Councilmember Dippolito. Any further discussion by council? All in favor of the motion, raise your hands. Passes unanimously.
Mr. Mayor, we're going to go to number four, approval of an ordinance to create the unified development code map. And since council member Nancy Diamond has been working on this since day one, I am going to turn this agenda item over to her.
We'll begin with the reading of the ordinance.
Thank you. This is an ordinance of the city of Roswell, Georgia, to create a unified development code, UDC, and map. Now, therefore, the mayor and council of the city of Roswell, Georgia, pursuant to their authority, do hereby ordain and enact this unified development and map, its articles, chapters, sections, and appendix A, attached hereto and incorporated herein by reference. Further, it shall be unlawful for any person to change or amend by addition or deletion any part or portion of such code, or to insert or delete pages or portions thereof, or to alter or tamper with such code in any manner whatsoever, which caused the law of the city of Roswell to be misrepresented thereby. And if approved, this will be the second reading of the ordinance.
Brad, you may proceed.
This is the second reading of the Unified Development Code. I'm probably gonna be more sitting over there at the computer. I'm gonna go through the text changes that were discussed on Saturday. This is the sheet that most of
everyone can select what you sit. Then we'll go to Councilman Eichelhardt's changes, his list that is going through there. Also, you will have a buffer table, the height map, and then the actual listing of the complete map changes. So stop me at any time. I don't think we have to go through a myriad of these unless we have discussion or policy changes that you think.
So as I understand it, you're going to be going through all of these, and where, at what point in time do you want council to respond?
Anytime along.
If they have a question,
they have a question or policy that they'd like to interject.
Before we proceed, Councilmember and Councilmember Diamond, I understand it. Would you tell the audience what your plan is on voting tonight?
Yes. Given that we had two work sessions this week, Monday and Saturday, and I would like to make sure that everybody has some time to review whatever changes that we're going to talk about tonight. So what we're looking at is basically a draft of the second reading, but I will be asking to defer the actual vote on second reading to the 24th of this month.
So we will have two opportunities for the public to be heard. We're going to be presenting your proposal, or Councilmember Wynn's proposal, and your proposal tonight. We'll hear comments from the audience. We'll hear comments and questions from council. But we're going to be deferring it for a vote for the next, for the 27th.
24th.
At the next regular council meeting. And at that regular council meeting, there will be another public hearing.
Yes, sir.
And further discussion. And an opportunity to amend.
Yes.
All right, you may proceed.
What I've placed on the screen is the beginning of the spreadsheet that was discussed at first reading. All of these changes were included as part of the first reading. One of the discussions that is taking place today is in this area of the section, which is number one, page 3-5, dealing with the suburban residential. It was adopted on first reading to put this wording back into the intent statement of the RS6 and RS4, and that's how it was approved on first reading. I believe placed at your seat this evening was wording from Councilman Orleans, which I have actually typed in to the resolution. So this area needs to be discussed this evening. He's asking for the term suburban residential to be removed from RS6, RS4, and RCC, and add language, other areas as defined by the comp plan, only in exceptional situations.
What I would like to do, as far as the order, is to have the presentation, any questions the council may have about the presentation, then a public hearing to get comments from the floor, and then discussion by council.
Okay.
And again, I understand Councilmember Wynn and Diamond will be asking for a motion for a vote.
Okay.
So, this isn't, I don't want to give a public hearing before we get in the debate, but if there are questions, you go along. I want a council member, if they've got any questions, he's going to please raise your hand or interrupt if I don't see anything. Please proceed.
Do we want to discuss this item anymore, but I'll go around?
I think we're going to hold.
Okay.
Just for the audience, they need to understand the issue. What were the two different proposals?
To leave.
That are being considered. Well, the first one is approved by the first reading and the counter by Councilman, the proposal by Councilmember Orleans.
Correct. The way it was adopted in the first reading was to put suburban residential as a allowable category for in the intent statement for RS6 and RS4. Councilman Orleans' alternative is to remove that language and put in other areas as defined by the comp plan only in exceptional situations.
Please proceed with your rest of the presentation.
This area is the further approved under first reading. This is the areas for the concurrent variance language adopted, added by the city attorney. The area in green was also adopted under first reading. The area in blue, the locations which are being proposed for second reading. The item number two was discussed of providing a double row of hedges. This was the language taken exactly from the city of Alpharetta's requiring double row hedges. The see some of the items indicated no action. The buffer matrix is something we'll discuss and bring up separately. This is in item number 10. This is language related to the Appendix A. We added clarifying language that indicates when a property abuts a protected district, a site plan shall be reviewed and approved by the mayor and council. I believe that was language Councilman Dippolito wanted clarifying as part of being in the condition, prior conditions of approval. This is the language being proposed that was brought forward by council member Price to be included in the second reading. This is the area of this language deals with the intent statement again. This is what staff had proposed originally, dealing with the suburban residential. This would be stricken from the motion to approve if adopted by the prior language. Some clarifying statements, just adding dealing with car washes, removing multifamily from the RTH, RM conditionally, and then RM2 and RM3. And that is all of the text changes that staff went through on our list for consent decree. You can go to Councilmember Eichelhardt's list if you wish to make your
round. This is a list for proposed amendments.
One of those.
I think we can summarize it. This is a long list, and I don't want to take the specific time to get to each detail. He can make that motion later, but if you could, and if Council Member Eichelhardt wishes to add some more to what Brad has to say,
I'll allow him to do that.
Brad, you want to try to summarize Councilman Eichelhardt's changes?
Okay.
And you can put it up on the screen, but we'll summarize this so the audience can understand the gist of it.
Councilman Eichelhardt started with a infrastructure sufficiency request. We have some preliminary language that was placed with your dais this morning that was similar to Raleigh's. You wish to review that. One of the requests was to change the effective date. The ordinance drafted in front of you has the effective date of June 1st, 2014. A lot of the discussion on Saturday dealt with percentages of open space, building setbacks, coverage setbacks. It was determined, or at least the consensus at the work session on Saturday, the majority of these were not changed. We changed some of the percentages from 25 down to 20. There were some questions related to interior setbacks for principal buildings that council wanted to ask Coke Studios about these. This is number 31 of the list. So we put the note on here, ask Lee. If the council still wants to do that, the appropriate time you can ask our consultant related to that. There was a request to change the leading seven stories and eight stories. From that was not changed. A lot of it was also to include larger minimum lot sizes. Those changes were not included. There were changes that were done to the buffer setbacks, which will be included in the buffer chart that we'll look at. So those were the majority of those changes. Then we got to a discussion on building mass to require more than 30,000 square feet required additional approval requirement for different locations for building mass. That was the majority of the discussion on Councilmember Eichelhardt's spreadsheet for text amendment change.
Councilmember Eichelhardt, any corrections or additions to that? I know we didn't cover it in detail.
Oh, sure. No problem. Just one thing that I thought that we had all agreed throughout. The landscape open space is 25%, the common open space is 20%. interested in. On here, it only says a couple times that it's 20%. Actually, now, you said it once or twice, but I only see it on 109, but as I understand, that's the landscape over the base of 25, and it's on 26 and 109.
I think you're correct.
Okay, and that's all right now.
I think through the document, landscape open space, where it is required, is to be 25%. The common open space requirement is to be 20%. So.
Any other presentation on the text? Mentioned the matrix. Right. What I'd like to do is cover all the presentation of the second reading before I go to the public hearing, including the map. Yes, Councilmember Wynn.
Mr. Townsend, on 138, did we ever figure out the parking table yet? Are we still working on that?
We didn't have a chance to get that information. I mean, you're asking the discussion as to the townhouse requirement?
Right, correct. So we're still looking into
that? We're still looking into that.
Okay, thank you.
Councilmember Dunn.
I think what I thought we were doing was going to reference what exactly we used to get to the number we got to, so that it showed it was a national standard that we were using.
Right.
And we were just going to reference that, so whatever.
Well, because our current table doesn't have a townhouse category, we're also going to add that. And that's what we were going to check with RDOT as to what the minimum requirements, as well as there was some concern as to making sure we had sufficient number of guests in that type of development also. So we wanted to make sure that number was accurate. We're still working on it.
Thank you.
Councilmember Price.
Six in the pink section where it does not say proposed second reading, what is the disposition of that item?
I don't think any direction was given to staff related to that item.
So we're leaving it as it was?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, what we did was rather than change IL to add a permitted uses, we changed the properties in question to IS. Which would better fit for.
Okay, so it, but it's blank there. So the proposed second reading is to have it in IX, is that correct?
Well, that's more of a map.
That's a map change instead of a text change.
We'll be getting to the map in a minute. We haven't covered the map provisions yet. The first round was covering the text provisions. I think you mentioned the matrix you want to cover, and I want to get cover the map.
But the specific question is, do we put a P in medical and office under IL? We're not suggesting that for this reading.
Right.
I just don't want that to slip through the cracks because it doesn't have a resolution here, and it was a no in column three. I want to make sure that is going to be either medical offices would be permitted in that area, or it's clearly going to go to an IX, and I don't know that we have that under the map recommendations. So I just want some consensus of council that we are going to allow medical office buildings on the south side of Hamry Road.
We'll be covering the map in a minute, if you can answer that question again, if it's not answered in the presentation.
Can I just ask for consensus of council whether they agree that medical offices should be allowed south side of Hamry Road?
I think the question is, are those properties going to be in IX? And I believe they're on our spreadsheet as IX.
Well, this is a spreadsheet and it just doesn't have a disposition. That's
the map spreadsheet, the one that has the property.
If you'll hold your question to the map, I will be able to back you.
Thank you.
I'm going to put language in this location to indicate requires map showing. So that would, on this spreadsheet, will indicate that it does need to be put on the map.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
I just don't want to slip through the cracks. Thank you.
Any other questions regarding the text? You may proceed with the presentation, Brad.
This is the offer table. The red indicates changes made at the work session. Removals of C and all of the employment districts related to where any of the employment or commercial districts abut the residential district. They're required to have the 40-foot buffer and type B, the landscaping and no wall requirement. Also, type B is required for any external development for the historic district, as well as in a PRD, the buffer is determined by the existing development that it would be adjacent to, making it more similar. Do you have any questions?
Does the council have any questions? Councilman Dr.
I've never seen this before, so I would like to reserve my opinion for the future, but first time I've seen this. Thank you.
Okay. Again, we'll be hearing, you'll have the opportunity to bring it up again and on the 24th. If you'll proceed with the map, I assume that's next.
That's next. The proposed height map, which I'm bringing up, as discussed on Saturday, the majority of the location for the height remains around the 400 Holcomb Bridge corridor. We have included the hospital at a seven-story, as well as the Mansell Overlook office park buildings that are currently built at 95 feet or plus. Four stories around the multi-family designation, the hotel is at seven stories, Kimley Clark at seven stories, the vacant property, and OCMS, Southwest Quadrant, Southeast Quadrant, seven stories, and four stories in the downtown districts. Everything else, other than what's indicated on the map, is three stories. That should be reflected on the map that you have in front of you.
Does the council have any questions regarding that? Any more information to present before we open it up for a public hearing?
I have the complete map spreadsheet. I don't know if you really need to go over everything. The spreadsheet is broken down into categories where, well, let me pull it up. This is the spreadsheet reviewed on Saturday. It provides approximately 2,800 pieces of property, the existing zoning, UDC zoning, what was approved on first reading, the ones that were left in question, and then researched and discussed at the work session on Saturday. And that gives the second reading indication of what they're being proposed. I don't believe Councilmember Price's properties. What were the addresses of those properties, Councilmember Price?
You mean the ones on Hamburg Road?
Yes.
I don't know the addresses.
Let me pull up a map and see if we can point them out.
I mean, it's basically any of the medical office buildings on from Alfred Highway to whatever Wills Road or beyond.
The blue is the section that is currently OP, which we felt would be consistent to put it back to an OP. I believe, Councilmember Price, you're talking about these lots here. Are those the ones?
No, I'm talking about the whole stretch of road. I think IX would be very appropriate for them. Then allow everything that would be allowed in OP.
So you're asking to rezone the industrial designations that are currently industrial here?
That are light industrial, yes. I mean, I thought we were trying to get away from spot zoning, so if we replace these back to OP, we're going to have spot zoning for, you know, just a few little properties.
Well, that's what council's direction was, whatever was OP to make it OP. So I'm trying to clarify where the IX would go.
I thought we had that discussion that all that stretch would be, instead of ILIL, it'd be IX.
Well, let me zoom out a little bit.
Unless there's some usage in OP that's currently OP that's not allowed in IX, I think IX would be a reasonable transition to keep it cohesive but not restrictive.
So does the council have a pleasure as to how we determine what we zone IX?
Just to clarify the question. Hembry Road is the road that is running east-west.
Correct.
And it would run, what are the roads between?
Alpharetta Highway.
To?
This well is here.
And so Councilmember Price is suggesting those properties that front on the south side of Hembry Road be zoned IX. Is that my understanding? When you say all, you talk about all the properties fronting on Embry, on the south side of Embry, be zoned IX.
Just that anything that's currently the usage is of a medical office building, it would be more appropriate to have it IX than IL.
All right. But I'm first trying to identify which parcels are you talking about. Are we talking about all the parcels fronting on the south side of Embry?
I can't tell you every single one. I mean, I know I have a few that I have personal interest in, but I think it should go beyond my personal interest.
And we are doing that, but as far as the ones that you're concerned about, the ones that you've identified as, if we include all the properties on the south side of Embry, the front of Embry, are we including all the properties you're concerned about? there's an area. So, Councilmember Price, I'm trying to identify.
1355. 1357. This looks completely vacant. 1325. Like 1455 are all the addresses on the south side.
All right, and they are currently zoned OP.
No.
These are currently zoned.
Those are all in zoned industrial.
They're all zoned industrial, and there's some doctor's offices on that in that corridor.
Right.
And IX would allow what uses?
Would allow the office and medical as a permitted use.
All right. And OP would not allow medical as a permitted use?
OP would. IL.
IL would not.
Would not.
So Councilmember Price is proposing that it be zoned IX, not IL.
Correct.
Are there any uses that are, that...
It's pretty compatible.
IX is compatible.
It's more compatible with OP.
Than are there any uses out there, existing uses, that IX would be inconsistent with? We're aware of.
Not that we're aware of.
All right, so Councilmember Price is proposing IX instead of IL.
Correct.
All right, and does the council members have any thoughts on that? Councilmember Dippolito.
Mr. Mayor, I think the two smaller buildings on, the one pointing to and the one next to it are office. I'm not sure what this building you're pointing to now, is that an office building as well? What's that best name?
Fulton Science Academy.
No, it's farther down.
Do you know what that building is?
Yeah.
They
used to have retails and sales in there years ago.
That's not David's place.
Or wholesale sale.
I would think those three buildings, the larger building and the two to the left of it, certainly would be more IX. The one that you're pointing to right now is very much a light industrial building.
Yeah, no, and that building that is pointing at right now, there are medical office buildings in it. There are medical offices. Are there actually businesses? Yeah.
It's a cluster. Also, if you go back the other way, there's a very light colored building. That white one that's very vertical, that one's also. All medical offices. And
we've got that in the commercial head.
We have that as location.
Now we've got that as a commercial.
Well, originally it was, commercial heavy, but then I think somebody went through and made it all OP. So I need to know where we are.
Councilmember Price, are you suggesting all of these properties be IX?
I believe that allows the most compatible usage and least restrictive use of those properties. And yes, I would propose anything that's an office building of sorts on that corridor be IX.
Currently on this map that is shown,
this map that we got a month or so ago, it shows it as IL. But the current, I think, staff.
The current reading, what is it shown as?
OP. Some of them.
Some of them. This one is shown as commercial heavy.
Any further, any discussion by other council members on this property? Councilmember Dippolito.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I agree that for the industrial buildings that have office uses, it should be IX. I think OP needs to get OP. Because we're trying to stick with equivalent zoning to the extent possible. So I would support a change like that.
You're supporting Councilmember Price's change?
Not the way I understand it.
All right. Well, we need to be, property specific here because just so everybody understands where they are. Which parcels
the properties that are permanent zoned OP support a change to OP. The ones that are light industrial that have office in them, I think we need to take an IX, because it's still an industrial zoning.
Do we need to go back to your other map to identify that, Brad? So I understand Councilmember Dippolito's position.
We can probably need to go back.
So the blue is OP.
The blue is currently zoned OP. We're proposing.
And you're OP. Captain Dippolito's suggesting it remain OP.
Correct.
The green, which fronts on Embry, you're suggesting IX. You're OK with IX.
Yes, because it's currently industrial. It's only industrial.
All right, Councilmember Price. And OP allows professional doctors, and IX allows professional doctors.
Correct.
Councilmember Price, does that position address your concerns?
Yes, to some extent. I mean, I'm concerned about reinserting OP into this character map, because that includes all the hospital. And I'm not sure, does that live at the hospital, since it otherwise would have been commercial heavy? So suddenly we're changing it back to OP. I don't know if they're aware of that.
Let's try to stick right now to the south side of Embry Road. We can talk about the north side of Embry next. But on the south side of Embry, Councilmember Dippolito is suggesting the areas in blue remain OP. They're currently OP. And you suggested the areas in green become IX. He's saying that's okay. I'm trying to see whether y'all two differ.
Well, personally, I'd like to see as little as of IL as possible, since it's very restrictive in use and allows adult business.
Well, we can talk about other parcels right now, but I'm specifically talking about the parcels south of Henry Road, which are in green right now, which is, I understand, the code for IL. And Councilmember Dippolito is suggesting that they go to IX, and I understand you're suggesting they go to IX. So on those parcels, you seem to be together. The parcels that are now in green would become a different color, whatever the color of IX is. Let's not go beyond those parcels. Let's stick to those parcels first to see if it's happening. If Councilmember Dippolito agrees that they should be IX and you would agree to IX, is anyone else who thinks they should be something different?
The question is which ones specifically? And how
specifically, if you take all those parcels that on the south side of Embry that are now green, they would become IX.
That abut the road.
That abut the road.
All the way to where? Wills or North Meadow Parkway?
Let's do this. Let's go address by address.
Councilmember Diamond, maybe you can clear something up.
I think we have the idea of what we're looking for here, and I think without us sitting here not knowing all the details of this, I think we need to come back. Regardless of what we decide here, we're going to go research all this and make sure that we're accurate in what we think we're seeing. But
right.
I don't know how much time we need. The intent is, we want to make sure, which I think we were pretty clear on, we want to make sure that the light industrial that's presently using it for office has that opportunity. And then we can come back and give you recommendations, because there's things at front Henry and then there's things behind them, and I'm just not comfortable sitting here next thing. And I think
in your motion, what do you anticipate your motion will be tonight on the map? Any changes from the map, or are you accepting any of these changes suggested by Councilmember Dippolito and Councilmember Parks?
I will throw them out as a second reading with pending research on it, because I'm not ready to
pick
parcels here at the table.
Let you think about it. You're going to formulate your motion. I think we've had a lot of discussion on this. We understand the issues.
I think I'm clear on that.
Councilmember Price, other matters you wish to raise?
I just like to see some clarity that we're not going down to the final wire to decide what happens to these. I want to know what's going to be in the final proposed wording.
There'll be a motion tonight. That motion will not be voted on for 2 weeks.
I'm not sure we'll have the final wording on anything right now, but we'll have at least something for the citizens to consider. It may not make all council members happy, but the citizens will know where this council is at. The motion's going to be that we're going to be voting on it. We'll entertain that motion after we hear from the public. Other comment questions from council before we open it up for public questions and comments? Councilmember Eichelberg.
Just one question on the things that all say ask we and all the things we're unsure of. Are we asking to do that later? Or
there will be a motion tonight and a second. And I understand there will be a request to defer that motion in the second, so there'll be further discussion of the motion in the second before we take a vote on it in 2 weeks. But there will be a specific motion and a second, and then I apologize. I'm not very good at understanding questions.
There are pieces throughout that says ask Lee or may have some clarification. Are we going to do that later? Are we going to do that later?
Here's what we're going to do. We're going to have public comment next. And then I'm going to, well, first, and then I'm going to entertain a motion, which I understand is going to be a part of that motion will be to have it voted on in 2 weeks. Then we'll have a full discussion back. Questions, comments, the proposed amendments, at this time.
I don't actually have any amendments, I guess just the point of things that we aren't clear about when we're going to become clear. Nancy has an
opinion. Nancy.
Can I propose that maybe we add the Ask Lee questions as part of our presentation so we can have all that information going into the motion?
When you say questions?
There's just a few things on the proposed motion where there's clarification from our consultant who's here with us tonight. So that might be helpful before.
Why don't we hear those clarification before we have the public hearing?
I do have one other comment. I have one other comment on the in NX multifamily is conditional as it is everywhere. We need to address the Roswell Housing Authority property, and I just want to have on the record that that is something that we will have a resolution to, if not tonight, before that final vote, because they now by right have that ability and they're the only ones that do, and we need to make sure that we've worded it in such a way to make sure that's covered, and we are working on that, so I don't want that to look like it's not being covered either.
All right, did you have some questions for our consultant?
I think Brad has the list there. We can run through the ask the questions.
Sorry, offer that up for your
next one was a limit on the maximum units per acre when abutting specific districts. I haven't actually seen this concept ever used anywhere. The intent of zoning typically is that rules within a district are consistent within a district. If you need another district, apply another district in between. So in other words, map that transition if you feel the need to map that transition. But asking a transition to occur within a district in which everybody else is allocated a package of rights that you don't achieve seems to be a bit of a challenge. So I would recommend not to use this transitional model and to figure out an alternative way to transition this. There's a series there are a series of questions which I believe are all for the downtown. Recommending that the downtown district maximum building size be shrunk to 20,000 square feet from 30. This is the maximum building size by right before a conditional use permit would be required. As I recall, we borrowed this idea from Broadway. That was the original idea, was that, oh my gosh, if we're going to have big buildings, we better look at them with more review horsepower than at the staff level only and have a public conversation, therefore the conditional use permit process. It's completely appropriate to consider where that line falls. I think what you want to think about here is the kinds of things that you might want to encourage in this district. For example, if you're trying to encourage a grocery store or other kinds of things that might have larger footprints, you ought to be a little bit cautious about where that line is set. But this is, for the most part, a policy question for you to gauge yourselves. In thinking about that, a typical modern corner drugstore is on the order of 12 or 15,000 square feet. So you're talking about a space that would be equivalent of two of those stuck together at that 30,000 foot level. If you wanted to change that, that's worth considering. I think if ever there were an area where you can probably manage some larger footprints, it's in the downtown area. Certainly there are other portions of the city where large footprints would be acceptable as well. But this is an area where larger footprints might be appropriate. You have lots of kinds of additional layers of authority here. You have potentially the historic district line over the top of these that helps you with infill development. You have your new design guidelines that will be available so that if you truly wanted to break up the mass of a large building and make it look like smaller buildings, you could use the design guidelines to do that. So in the end, I'm not terribly concerned about where this number falls. And in fact, I might be willing to eliminate the number completely and not have to obligation. This is again an open policy question for you. That's as much background as I would probably want.
Councilmember Dippolito.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I would say your last name, but Mr. Eisman. I believe this issue is in the roadway district as a use, but not as a building mass itself.
As a tenant space.
Yeah, yes. I think we're kind of mixing apples and oranges here, where 30,000 was meant to control tenant size, so we didn't get larger boxes, and we had 30,000 feet because we could accommodate a specialty grocery store, too large of a grocery store. So the part of the discussion the other day was, do we need to have a building mass at all? To your point, some of these areas may have larger building footprints, but a lot of that is controlled through the design guidelines, where you can't have continuous line of building, you have to break it up and so forth. So I think you were kind of hinting at, we may drop this all together. Is there a way to insert use?
Well, so the tenant space question is a very different one. And frankly, if you'd have to really believe that you're going to get only the right things if you get only small spaces. And that's true at much smaller slices. So for example, in Palm Beach, the maximum size for a tenant space is 2,000 square feet. And when the Gap asked to open two stores next to each other and connect the door in between, they lost a court case in trying to set up that 4,000 square foot space. So clearly we can do those kinds of things if we're really looking for a very specific scale of tenant. At 20 or 30,000 feet, and especially if that's just a tenant space and I can then have adjacent tenant spaces, which is what Roswell would have allowed, we didn't feel that was doing anything for it. So we turned it into the building footprint, thinking that what you were more concerned about was bulk and mass, rather than this other question, which is a little bit more about tenant. Yes, it makes sense to set tenant spaces. If you're going to set them, you would set them for places like Canton Street, the sort of precious spaces, and you would set them substantially smaller than what we're looking at here. Otherwise, I don't think I would be tempted to set the tenant space mark. And if the bulk and mass is managed by both existing parcel sizes and the processes that they'll have to go through in the future, then you don't need this other session.
Other questions? Councilmember Dunn, anything further? You're not excused. We still may. Any further comments from council before I open it up to the floor? At this time, any of you in the audience, you have any questions or comments, we'll hear from you. So if you come, yes sir, come forward. You'll give us your name and address. We do have a 5 minute time.
Jere Wood, Council, Lee Fleck, Martin's Landing. Is this overhead on?
We can get it on. Yes, sir.
Thank you. The one item that I wish to talk to this evening, and I feel very strongly about, is the first recommendation Councilman Ivey, and that is the infrastructure sufficiency clause to be added, recommended to be added to the EDC. I feel so strongly about it, I want to read the general statement of what an infrastructure sufficiency requirement is, which is taken, as you can see it, from the city of Roswell, or city of Raleigh's Unified Development Ordinance Code, whatever you want to call that. I think there's a very prudent clause that they've included, and I don't see why it would be of such objection to be put into your code. Infrastructure sufficiency in general is to lessen congestion in the streets and to facilitate the efficient and adequate provisions of transportation, water and sewer, and to secure safety for fire. Every subdivision plan and site plan shall be subject to a determination of the sufficiency of the infrastructure. And it goes on to say the infrastructure shall be considered sufficient where it is demonstrated to have available capacity to accommodate the demands generated by the proposed development, as well as other approved developments and master plans. In order to avoid undue hardship, the applicant may propose to construct or secure sufficient funding for the facilities necessary to provide capacity to accommodate the proposed development at the adopted level of service. the commitment for construction or advancement of necessary facilities shall be included as a condition of the development. I think that is a very prudent portion that should be considered strongly. And so I wholeheartedly support Councilman Eberhardt's initial proposed out of this list. Other than that, personally, I think that the cottage houses are a very bad plan, no matter where they're going to be. Since I have so much time left over, I really think, I know you've done a lot of work on this and everything, and one thing that still concerns me is that, you know, that what we're talking about here is big government, higher densities, traffic congestion, crime, negative impact on schools, and this is all going to be an integral part of this UBC. My big major concerns is what type of public safety input has been provided by either Chief Grant or Chief Spencer. Because I'm sorry if you haven't reached these subjects in all good conscience. How the hell can you consider something, Mr. Mack? Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Davidson, have you had the opportunity to review the language with Mr. Reed, like the rest?
Not exactly. Well, part of that language, yes. And while I agree with part of what he said, we do have developmental impact fees already in place in the city of Roswell, which would force the developer to pay for the portion of improvements that his project would cause, not system improvements, but the stuff that would be for his project. Other issues such as traffic, the Georgia Supreme Court has said you can't base a rezoning decision solely on traffic. There's other areas where obviously we can base decisions, and traffic can be considered. But traffic alone or roads are not the only thing that you can base it on. So, yes, I've reviewed the language. I don't disagree with what he is proposing. It's just that we have things in place already. And because we do have the developmental impact fees in place already, if we try to get more from the developer, then that would be an extraction, and that's not legal.
Do you have concern about the how the constitutionality of our ordinance if we include the language as Mr. Fleck read, and you advise council on?
Yes, I believe that it would be unconstitutional to do it the way that he just read.
And is that because there's a difference in Georgia law and North Carolina law?
Absolutely, yes.
All right, so you advise council against that specific language?
That specific language. You can consider what infrastructure is available, but requiring them to build infrastructure that would be a system improvement, you cannot do.
Thank you, sir. Who'd like to speak? Yes, next, come forward, please.
Good evening, my name is Linell. I'm a resident of Roswell, 211 Quail Road. Which is a townhome community within Martin's Landing. I am chair of the Martin's Landing Community Development Committee, and I've been asked by the board to read a letter from them regarding their concerns into the record. Mayor, council members, as the UDC proposal moves forward, Board of Martin's Landing would like to share their continuing concerns regarding this important piece of legislation. We appreciate your encouragement and community input on this complex issue. While the necessity of an update to the current zoning regulations is well understood and recognized as a positive move forward, there continue to be elements in the proposed ordinance that are a serious concern to the neighborhoods of Martin's Landing. As set forth below, and we request request your consideration as follows. We recommend that 7 stories should be the maximum height for structures with no bonus or additional stories included in any character area. These building heights are already far in excess of MLF community preferences. We specifically ask you to look at the corridors and node district section. Originally on pages 4 through 6, but even with the revisions, it may be different pages. And the employment districts, pages 4 through 6. The MLF board also continues to have deep concern over the number of parcels with conditional allowance for apartments, especially within the MLF school attendance zones. We request that a mix of uses be a requirement for any rezonings to mixed-use categories on parcels 10 acres in size or larger. Although specific ratios would be difficult to prescribe, a minimum of 2 uses, mixed either vertically or horizontally within a proposed site of this size, should be required to meet the intent of mixed-use walkable projects. We request that the intent section of the 2030 comprehensive plan regarding the southeast quadrant area be included in the review of any rezoning requests in the area for compliance. We request that the UDC include a statement, for example, city approval of a rezoning or conditional use request does not relieve a property owner of their responsibility to meet the requirements of all applicable neighborhood covenants and secure the approval of their neighborhood HOA in the appropriate article, so that an individual resident within the MLF community or any homeowners association is clearly aware of the need for review of compliance with MLF covenants or their appropriate association covenants. Request that the approved MLF site plan be carried over to the UPC with corrections as noted in prior notifications through your discussions. Request that there be a clarification of Stub Street to define public versus private and elimination of the requirement of a new subdivision to provide a vehicular connection to privately owned Stub Streets. The Board of Martin's Landing would again like to thank the Mayor and Council for their outreach and openness to input from the community as it moves forward with its attempts to update and simplify our zoning ordinance. And this is presented by the Martin's Landing Board.
Thank you. Does anyone else have any questions or comments? Yes, sir, come forward, please.
My name is Robert Griest. I'm with Smith Gambrell Council, 1230 Peachtree Street. I'm here on behalf of MetLife, my client, and have a question on clarification for a prior rezone in terms of conditions. In 2009, there was a rezone of our property in Mansell Overlook, where we were proposing to do a development. And as a condition of that 2009 rezone to OCMS, we must develop in terms of substantial accordance with the site plan. My question is, and my client's question is, that there is a 4,000 square foot retail center which is on that site plan, and this area being considered to be zoned as office park, retail is very limited and OP. And our question is whether we can obviously build this in accordance with the site plan, but will we be able to carry over the uses that were available under OCMS, or basically be effectively prevented from building the 4,000 square retail foot as it is on the site plan?
Mr. Townsend, can you respond to that question?
Is my understanding the council brought uses forward. So anyone, the use that was allowed at the time would be maintained, as well as any use that was prohibited would still be prohibited. That would be my understanding.
Mr. Davidson, you can say that.
I guess I think that was a condition of that rezoning, so those conditions would come forward. I think their question is,
it says retail on the site plan, and they don't know exactly what's allowed in retail. And I spoke with Matt earlier today, and we allow retail, so it would be anything that could fit in a 4,000 square foot building that is retail, so.
Have we clarified anything?
Yeah, but in Office Park, I mean, retail, you have to have multiple tenants, it can't be a standalone building, so you're talking about a 4,000 square foot building where you have to have multiple tenants. There's also, I mean, the restrictions on retail are just so strict, you can't have a restaurant, because, you know, a lot of stuff in OT is basically, you know, unless you have it as an accessory use in a larger building, such as the, you know, office buildings in Mansell Overlook. I mean, there's just not, there's really nothing that a client would be able to do with 4,000 square feet if it does build that building in accordance with the site plan.
Councilmember Dippolito.
Mr. Mayor, thank you. Do we have a copy of the site plan? Good question. Yes, bring a copy with you. Can you put it on your picture?
Sure.
Okay, because that parcel, we actually, I think so, in the corner and existing retail, we're actually making CX, which gives you even more flexibility. Which is the parcel?
The parcel question is right here. And I believe under the map that this, which is existing, or this is CX, we're asking.
Ray, I'm going to pull up the map so we can confirm what the proposed zoning map would be.
We attempted to use CX when you had retail slate.
So, where's the parcel?
Let me call up this. This parcel here.
It's the parcel in red.
It's the one directly to the right with that red.
So it's in blue?
Correct. It's OB7.
Mr. Chass, I think the intent was to pick up that whole corner, which would be those two buildings.
Yeah. Rich, are you suggesting that they're probably picked up in red?
Yes, the two buildings, because it looks like it's hard to judge from this specific map. It might actually
looks like we only pick up the first one.
You want to get an over, you want to get an aerial of this?
Well, it's vacant land, so it's an aerial.
Oh, it's not going to tell us.
It's not going to show.
The site plan is better.
So, but the
intention was to pick up those two, that whole corner.
To include the parcel he's talking about, it would be to zone it what?
CX.
CX. Are you familiar with what CX allows?
It's commercial mixed use.
Yes. Would CX be acceptable to your part?
Yeah, I believe that would cover it all.
So it's this vacant parcel as well as this vacant parcel.
I will encourage Nancy and Betty to consider this. If you'll give us the address on this parcel that you're concerned about.
It's vacant, so I don't think it has that street address. I'll give you a PIN number.
PIN number? That would be a parcel identification number.
Here to represent
Roswell has a 2030 master plan, which requires any new development to be compatible with the adjacent existing character with similar densities and lot sizes. The potential rezoning of Chaffin Road would not...
Before we go forward, let's, if we can pull up the map and see what the map change is going to be to make sure we're all on board. So does the, what is the map going to be, proposed map going to zone this property? So I mean, but under, I know it's under that general category, but...
The gray in this area is the civic locations.
Okay, and the, that would be the school, the church.
Lebanon Baptist Church.
All right. And I'm trying to get the which property are we talking about that you're concerned about the, this map?
So Ivy Mills is right. So the area directly across Chaffin Road.
And Chaffin, and that, and the map is proposing that to be
RS-30 as it currently exists.
So we're not, this map is not proposing any change.
She's talking about the potential for it to happen.
There, I understand you're opposed to something of a potential, but as far as this map,
okay,
and what this, I'm assuming the motion is going to be is not to make a change tonight.
Okay.
Or any time without an application and more hearings and planning commissions and the whole shoot match. So right now there's no proposed change.
That sounds great.
Can we allow her to finish on the reading?
Anything you'd like to add to that? Thank you.
Okay. Do you have that question?
If the council has any comments, we'll hear from them when it's time for the council comment.
But specifically, can I ask her a question?
Certainly, you may ask a question.
So, are you concerned about the zoning category or a change in use or change in types of buildings that could be there?
Moreover, you know, right now, the way Chaffin Road exists, it's large lot sizes, you know, less housing, and we enjoy that. We enjoy the green space. We enjoy the large lots. So just any change in that, we would be opposed to.
So just to clarify that, could staff answer if there's anything in RS-30 that wasn't in RS-30 previously that would now be allowed there?
Uses
or types of structure?
Not in the RS-30 now.
So RS-30 is identical.
The concern has been stated numerous times is not about that specific reason. I mean, it's about what can be allowed. The intent statement allows RS-4, 6, and CC to continue in the suburban residential.
I think that's an opportunity for council to make an argument, but as far as her question...
Cut off her comment.
And any more comments you'd like to make? Well, I was trying to respond to the question. The question was, is the current map is not making a change?
If the current map is not, if we're not proposing a change, I mean, right now we live on a very quiet suburban street that we very much value and enjoy, that we'd like to see.
And the current zoning is, the lot size is not going to change from the existing to the proposed. Lot size is not changing.
And density is not changing.
Density, if you're talking about lot size, the lot size and number of units per on that lot is not changed.
Okay. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you. Other comments or questions from the floor? Yes, sir. Come forward.
Jere Schumacher from 405 Prospect Street. I want to thank the council and the mayor for allowing me to sit in on and participate in some of the conversations and a lot of work sessions in the DC the last few weeks. I really appreciate it. It was a great insight into how things work, and sometimes So I'd like to comment on residential cottage core. I'm very concerned about us creating what is essentially RS 1.2 lot size with no ingress egress requirements. This is a large concern because the site also does not require any frontage itself, which could potentially allow somebody to stack a number of sites together to create a lot of landlocked lots that are 1,200 square feet each, which could present a fire problem, safety problem, legal problem, and certainly creates a very, very high density when we have 1,200 square foot lots. Because you can horizontally mix cottage court with other types, consider that you could potentially be seeing requests for putting cottage court buildings on existing properties that currently have townhouses. So for instance, if a current townhouse development has large buffers, and those buffers are going away under the EPC, for instance, cottage courts could be placed in those locations because you can mix. There's no guarantee that any of the cottage court courtyards are actually budding any of the cottages as well. So potentially a company could say that the existing parkland inside of a townhouse development is the allotted cottage court square footage. So I'm concerned about horizontal mixing. I'm concerned about ingress egress frontage problems. In fact, we don't have frontage requirements for our sites. We don't have any language around how many sites go together. I'm also concerned that we have an intent for cottage courts that should be surrounding a courtyard, but that's an intent. It doesn't sound like it's a legal requirement or a rule requirement rather than intent. And I'm concerned that if somebody comes to council or comes to staff and makes a request for a variance to have a long string of cottages with some green strips for our courtyard, that might be passed without much concern or by staff. I'm not really sure. I would like David to address the intent wording in the EDC itself and whether intent really is a requirement or do we actually need to put stronger language in a lot of our categories to ensure there are actual requirements for our building types so that we really meet the intent that we think we're going to see. I'm concerned about accessory buildings not having a square footage maximum. Okay? We have a square footage maximum today. That maximum is the size or smaller than the primary building on the lot. Because we're getting rid of accessory building maximums and our setbacks are much smaller. You can build outside the building on the low. You could potentially be seeing accessory buildings that are being built in those setbacks much larger than the primary building. So I think that we should add back a maximum on accessory building size. Districts are not defined in the document itself, but there is much talk about districts, especially when it comes to boundaries on the maps. Page 1-4 talks about interpretation of boundaries for districts, but we need to see these districts on the maps to understand where these building types and zoning types will come up. How can anybody in Roswell know what's going to happen in their neighborhood if you don't tell them what your intent is for those district boundaries and how that fits the comprehensive plan? You know, somebody may come up and say they're really for RS4, RS6 lots because they own a big piece of land. I think they're crazy to think about RS4 and RS6 when we've got residential cottage court. So please think about residential cottage courts. If you're really going to maximize your density and make something that the rest of Roswell isn't interested in. Further, I would say that I'm glad there are documents in the back, but realistically, the public cannot understand everything we presented to have an official second reading on this document. It's impossible to understand. And I say that because I've been at all the meetings, I know what you talked about, but it's impossible to know what is in the UPC based on a first reading document, multiple spreadsheets with short wording and references is impossible and unrealistic. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Davidson, would you respond to the question regarding the intent statements? You may have a student.
The intent statement is this, is just that. They can be changed by the mayor and council. It's just the intent. It doesn't obligate the council to anything. It could be used, obviously, in court by somebody that's unhappy with a decision of the mayor and council. But again, it's not an obligation of council. So.
You may sit down.
Could I ask a question specifically about Cox Burnett definition?
One more question.
In the intent statement.
Then you may sit down.
Thank you. I appreciate it. With the intent statement with Cottage Court, for instance, the intent is that the cottages are surrounding the water, but there isn't any language in the rule for the Cottage Court as a building type to ensure that that actually happens. Does the intent in that section actually require somebody to build surrounding a courtyard, or is it just a suggestion? Rather, we rely on the wording of the building type in the different zones.
You may have a seat. Lee, can you respond to that question?
I think it depends on what your definition of intent is. So building types have definitions associated with them. If we look at one of those,
I agree that there should be some
way to address the sufficiency of the traffic infrastructure. Let's see what my top ones are here. One of the other things that I had as a key item was the transition from the corridor of no districts to the residential. And I think Lee brought up one of the ways that we could handle that, which would be at some point maybe create another transitional district between some of those corridors and the suburban residential. And I also see the problems in doing that, because in a lot of those places, we're bringing, we only have one parcel depth between serious suburban residential with fairly low densities and the commercial corridors, Highway 9 and Holcomb Bridge. But I think it's something that we should consider, and I can imagine if anything that might be where townhomes and cottage courts and such would be appropriate as well. There was one section where I found some conflicts between the Bill 2 zone at corners and pedestrian access in the forecourts. If you look at page 2.7, it says a facade must be within the first 30 feet of the Bill 2 zone facing each street. That contradicts one of the things that we had in the roadway plan, which was that there could be a special treatment at the corners so that you could provide something that was rounded, angled, what have you. So that instead of having the entire corner all the way come all the way out there, you could do something on a significant corner that would be much more architecturally pleasing. So we may want to take a look at that. One of the other things that was listed was on page 2-14, the forecourts. The maximum width and depth should be weighed against each other. Right now it says the maximum depth is 35 feet, maximum width is 35. Now I don't know if we want to avoid, or if this is something that could be left to design a review board, but I don't think we would envision having something that's 35 feet long and say 6 or 8 feet wide. I don't think that's necessarily what we're looking for. So there might be something there or in the design guidelines that would address that. The other thing is, again, can a forecourt happen within that first 30 feet of the corner of a building? There might be places where we want to do that a little closer for having outdoor dining, what have you. So there might be something that we have to give in terms of following the BTC right there. Sorry, some of these terms are probably not going to make sense to everyone else here. Let me see some of the other highlights. So in the 2-15, we have the various garage layouts for detached homes. I noticed number 4 is one that is really not meeting the design intent, I think, for a lot of the structures here. It's one where you have the garage directly in front of the house, basically blocking the entire facade. And I just wondered if it might be appropriate to put in there that this is something that is not a preferred, a discouraged out possibility. Other things in there, we don't have any that are fitting some of the existing conditions where you actually have the garage not detached, but attached on the back of the house. I think that's fairly common, actually, around town.
To wrap up, I'm sure that the council will review these comments in the email, but any last closing words?
3 parcels that still need to be looked at, and I will get those. Well, I already have those to grab, but I can send a copy to all of you as well. Thank you for the time, and thank you for your diligence, and I hope you do consider these last few things.
Thank you. There were a lot of things to consider. There were a few questions. Ms. Love, what's your comment? Nancy has her hand up.
I want to apologize. I misunderstood Lisa the way we had left that. I know you came in with that printed sheet on Saturday and we weren't able to get to it by the end, but I thought at the end we had talked about that a lot of those had been covered in the work session and that you were going to kind of knock off the ones that we already covered and send it back in Excel form so that we could add those together. So I'm sorry if I didn't read that correctly, but we will absolutely get through whatever.
Can I respond real quick? I did not post them off. There were only a few that I left on here were things where we hadn't actually seen the text that had been discussed, but I wanted to do that. For the most part, these are probably 95% things we didn't discuss.
Right, okay.
Councilmember Price?
Mr. Carbo, if I may ask you a question.
Come back.
Are you speaking as an individual, or are you speaking from the Planning Commission, or has the Planning Commission given any disposition on the UDC as a whole?
No, we have not. I'm guessing that we're going to be addressing that this month. And I'm sure we'll have a few more questions and comments in that too. But these are my review comments as a citizen and as a member of the planning commission, yes.
Okay, but as far as the planning commission goes.
I'm not speaking for the planning commission. I'm only looking at this through my duty of review.
But do you feel like the planning commission has come to any unanimity of recommendation or thought on this?
I couldn't speak for everyone else.
Thank you.
Thank you. You did raise a couple of questions I think we can respond to. The questions regarding past conditions, we get a summary of what the proposal is regarding past zoning conditions, where we stand today. It would be, Brad, are you the right person to answer that question? Thank you. Anyone else have any questions or comments? I see no hands up. Come forward, please.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. My name is Nydia Tisdale. I live in Brookfield Country Club. And I'd like to thank the members who came and addressed our homeowners association yesterday afternoon concerning the UDC. Thank you for your time. I was at the work session on Saturday all day. It lasted from 11 a.m. to close to 5:30 p.m. And yes, a quorum was lost towards the end of the day as members had to leave. And the tape recording was turned off. And I was also asked to cease my video recording at that time. The video that I was able to capture was available on YouTube. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else have any questions or comments? Public hearing is closed. You'll have another opportunity to speak at the public hearing at the on the 24th. And you'll also, we do encourage you to contact council members and staff with your questions and comments, and we'll try to respond to those. Council Member Diamond.
Yes, sir. There were two other documents that we didn't talk about. One was section 11.5, infrastructure sufficiency. There was a couple of items suggested to be added there. It's the one with A through D on your sheet. And the last two lines are red. We can kind of run through that. And also the 1.3.2 use and enforcement of the sign guidelines. We could just kind of go over that. Make sure we have everything on record.
Basically, this is language that was drafted in an attempt to come up with something that would give some comfort level for infrastructure sufficiency and also be in accordance with the state impact fee regulations. The difference with the city of Raleigh is that apparently if you look at their language, they don't have impact fees. They don't have the restrictions that the state of Georgia has. So we put this in an attempt to give a comfort level that infrastructure would be looked at when a project comes forward, which it currently is. This language is very similar to language that's in the current zoning regulations. Currently, the city of Roswell has multiple design guidelines, which we basically enforce from the standpoint of when a project goes through review, in particular when a project is reviewed by the design review board or the historic preservation commission. And at that time is when the design guidelines become standards and become enforceable, because they are made as conditions of the project. Again, this is an attempt to give everyone a comfort level that the design guidelines will be looked at and they will be enforceable through the normal process of review and approval.
Thank you. Can I ask a question?
This is what I would like to do.
There still need some legal massaging, but this is the basic language from staff.
As I understand it, there is a desire to make a motion and then to defer the vote after another public hearing until the next regular council meeting, but to have a definite motion for folks to consider and then post that on our website so folks can review the details. Do we have a motion?
Yes, first I'd like to number these in a way that we can kind of get an order. Consistency to it. Our original sheet called second reading draft, I'd like to call that UDC 1. The item mark, Michael Hart proposed UDC changes, like UDC 2. Sorry, I should have done this sooner, I just thought about it. The Roswell buffer table would be UDC 3. Parcel 12-226-005-59081, SCX. And I'm going to say review for the intent, for the conversation that we had about moving IX on Hembry from IL to IX in those parcels. We'll bring forward something for review, but hopefully you got the intent of where we're headed on that. The adoption date of this would be June 1st, or the adoption of the design guidelines, whichever is later. Got a few comments after that, but and then I would like to.
Is that the effective date you're talking about? The adoption date would be the date approved. The effective date is when it goes into effect.
Right, the effective date.
So June 1st.
Yes. And then to defer this vote on this motion until February 24th in order to get full review for all text and map amendments in accordance with this motion. Right.
Do I have a second?
Second.
All right, now the vote is going to be not on the motion because there's a request to defer. The vote is going to be on the deferral part. And so we're going to be voting on whether to defer this vote until the 24th. Councilman Orlos.
Councilman Diamond, your inclusion of UDC number one.
I missed your paragraph, I'm sorry.
Does that include what was
yes.
shown tonight on
yes.
the screen versus what we have in our packets? Different wording?
Yes.
We're voting on deferral. Councilman Rygar.
Two questions. I meant to ask on the map. Is this big spreadsheet have the one that I initially asked about in the group?
I don't think it includes the two Griest Hill land deeds that you discussed on Saturday.
Frankly, I don't remember everyone, but you know, whatever we went through.
And then the other ones that were allowed on 120 covered.
Councilmember Dunn really needs to respond.
Well, I think some of that was after the quorum, so we didn't have a consensus, but we can absolutely call that forward.
And the second question was, when do we think we will actually get a written version of all the things that we have here so that we will be able to review it? And do we intend to have another work session before this final vote? If there, because I'm, you know, as we saw tonight, there are at least two things that we didn't get exactly right from Saturday. So,
if it's the pleasure of the council, we'll have another work session.
But that third part,
sure what you think. We can certainly have another work session. Lee, you seem to motion to have this.
Well, let me share for everybody's edification. There is no possible way that a clean draft. The level of annotation and change can be prepared for the 24th. So
you need another day.
You will be bringing forward the prior draft and the summary of changes as you have been in the past.
So are you looking for a clean one or just a summary change?
I think we'll try to flesh out the summary a little more so that people can follow a little more because there's a lot of things that are similar in a bunch of different places.
But there will be a complete version if you read the original and the changes.
Yes.
When would we have the cobble together complete version? Something for Councilmember Eichelhardt and anyone else who is saying, what are we voting on? When would they have the in a written form?
We can publish all these.
It's all in written form right now.
Yeah, but frankly, things are as they are, so we have to pass it to know what's in it. That's what we're going to have to do.
That would be a legal question, but what I'm understanding is the motion to defer will be to the 24th, and what will be available is what Councilmember Diamond has enumerated. Councilmember Dippolito.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I guess I'm in the middle of this, but you know, I would like to see at least the consolidation of all these documents in numeric order as they fit in the book, so we can take a copy of the latest draft of the book, and then go down with all the changes and make sure all the changes are there. And right now, it's seven different pages, and they're not in the same order, so it's not easy.
So when do we think we would have what Mr. Dippolito is asking for?
It's relatively straightforward to resort the spreadsheet portions in the correct order by page number and by section number. If you're comfortable with the rainbow that will generate because of the colors will not be commingled, I think it'd be within a couple of days that we could have that back and available to post.
I'm comfortable not having colors.
That would be just fine. If this wants to simply be the second reading spreadsheet, it can be with all of it together at the same time.
And there are a number of items that we've said we're not going to make changes to, so eliminate the confusion that's brought those. Yep. So just have a listing of all the changes so we can go through chronologically as the series of time.
So that what you would be looking at on the 24th would be the prior text document and a single spreadsheet of the changes in order by page number and section.
Yeah. Question, when would that be available? I know we've been proposals voted on the 24th. When it would be available to the general public?
I think we can have it available in a couple of days' time.
Thank you, sir. Other questions? Councilmember Eichhardt.
My real concern on that is that there are a number of things we've said about what we'll work on that. We'll get that, or we'll, like I suggested, can we please rearrange the pages and talk about height so we can figure out what it actually intends? Are we going to see what that is, or are we just saying we're passing to say, yeah, we're going to do that? Out of all the things I've always carried with me, somehow I don't have the one sheet on the buffers, but I know what was in my notes is not what's on here, but I can't find it tonight because I don't have exactly. So I just know there are things that we are on here that we didn't intend, or we don't understand as a group what we did. Just human nature. I'm not saying it's anybody's fault. It's just the way things, when you have so much you're dealing with, there's no way it's correct. And this is embarrassing to say that we're going to move forward on this. And it's a total change to our code.
Councilmember Bryce.
Just a couple of clarifications, please. I'm in the northwest area of the city, and at one point during one of our small work sessions, we talked about some of that FCA going to ag as opposed to, as was proposed on one of the earlier maps, RS 30, which, and I'm not sure where that shows a that we adopted or agreed to that recommendation. Do we have a disposition on that? It looks like it's blank in my papers.
Tabs, do you understand the question?
Yes.
Do you have an answer?
Just a second. If you look at the screen, can I press?
Yes, yes.
This area was changed to ag. This area was changed to ag. Also included was this area to ag. This area over here, I think you requested ag, but it has its current zoning. It was not FCA at the time, so we left it with its current zoning.
Okay, so does this map show on the website, or if somebody were to look at the map and wonder what's going to come, would they see this?
Yep, adopted with the changes this evening, yes.
Okay, the other thing, a couple of things. One was, we talked about garages with garage doors, and pointed out on the narrow lot, or the small recess, whether or not we would have to have the vertical division in the garage doors. And then it looked like some sort of retribution was got included in some other designations that would also have to have that vertical pole in the garages. How did we end up with that, since I was not at the short called work session?
I'm thinking that was in the design guidelines comment that we could create
the language that was added to the second.
No, yeah, that, the previous work session, I said, well, maybe the design folks could look at that, but again, I don't know what was finally decided.
The original discussion was to remove this line from line one. The consensus was to actually add this line to line two.
Right.
That's how it's being proposed.
So, because I brought it up, it's now going to be more restrictive for a person's choices in having their garage door functional as opposed to looking aesthetic, which we can certainly do aesthetic garage doors without putting a pole down the middle. So right now, the wording in the newest version is going to have an additional restriction of having a vertical pole in that structure number two, or B or whatever, the second one. Is that correct?
That's my understanding.
Is that everybody on council's understanding?
Yep.
I mean, I couldn't find it. Okay, the other one was, if you take the current map that we've been given, and then the one we were showing this evening, we now show that Cornwall Hospital is OP, and I don't know how we got to that. Was that part of the discussion at the work session? Or did it just sort of morph into OP somehow?
I think it was the office buildings that are on that property.
We can pull up the map. Get the border and identify the Norfolk Hospital property.
This is the hospital location that is currently zoned OCMS. This is the OP on the south side of Emory. I'm losing track of when we did things, but I think the request was to make that OCMS OP and give it the height that it currently has. And that's what this map reflects.
Does the OP allow the hospital
and the office?
Yeah, it's not all hospital. There are a number of other parcels there.
But it's all OCMS.
Currently.
Yes.
So, since the previous map and the letter they would have gotten reflected commercial heavy, how significantly different is this that they are faced now with a totally different change that they're not aware of?
I don't know.
Well, does anybody care that they be informed that a totally different category has been designated for them that may have ramifications for their usage?
Well, since it was a policy decision of council, you may want to direct that to council.
Councilmember
Well,
Diamond.
I've asked a lot of questions of council and I haven't heard an answer yet.
Councilmember Diamond would like to go back.
I think once our policy was, the consensus was go to the closest thing to what they have now. This does the closest thing to what they have now without taking red rights that they have. Now, we're not giving them additional rights, but we're not taking them away either. So this was the closest matching zoning to what they have presently.
So we didn't think that CH was that when we made it CH? Thought that's what we were trying to do. Why do we now think OP is closer than when we made it CH?
You would have to poll individual council members who were at the meeting, but that was, it's my understanding they believe that was the closest correlation to the current zone.
We've made some adjustments and uses of things along the way, too, so keep it consistent.
Can I have a list of those usage changes?
You may request that of council.
I'd like a list of the usage changes in that designation.
Right, you'd like a list of usage changes in the OP from what originally proposed to what it currently is?
Correct. Or anything else that we'll happens after that, if it's new.
We will get you that list of changes from original OP to current OP.
And any other changes that happen Saturday that are different?
I think that you'll need, if you would like to know those, then the record is available for your review.
And
Well, apparently the...
And on YouTube.
And on YouTube.
Well, apparently the film was turned off and as a...
There were no changes made after the film was turned off, to my knowledge.
And why was the lady now just asked not to continue filming?
Kay, if you'll respond.
Yes, the work sessions and the council meetings are public meetings that are recorded. And at that time, we lost a quorum. We were no longer in a work session or mayor and council meeting. We were more in a staff meeting. The public was not asked to leave. They were still remaining there to hear the discussion. But we did not want it misrepresented. The video is out on YouTube after we have ended the work session, that was some public meeting that would be recorded. The city should drive based on our policy when the recording starts or stops. That's the official record. We don't tape our staff meetings or our other meetings that are not the meetings of the mayor and council. That's why the person was asked to quit recording. However, they could continue to be there and hear the conversation.
So may I ask who was at the meeting when the recording was turned off?
Certainly, you may ask. Who was present after, who was there to the bloody end? I see some hands out there in the audience. I was not present. Well, which of the council members present?
Three.
It was Diamond, Wynn, and Igelhart.
And throughout the day, there were members of the public there, I assume?
Correct.
Is there a record of that?
Correct, there is. That the public hearing and the public part of work session is recorded and available. Both on...
We don't have the name. Like tonight, we don't have the name for it.
But it's available for review.
It is or isn't? Mrs. Clark says it isn't.
Councilman, the work session portion of the meeting, which is all after that meeting adjourned, but the work session is available for your review.
Correct. However, we don't have individual names of the public present at that work session, just like we don't any work session. The public doesn't sign in.
If the person spoke,
correct,
would their name be taken down. Just tonight, we don't take roll of everybody who did. Other questions? All right. We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Yes, sir, a second.
We have a motion and a second. And the motion was to, is specific as to what they're proposing, but they're asking for a vote now to defer the vote until the 24th. Any further discussion of that? Councilman Igelhart.
I wasn't prepared to vote for a deferral. I thought that was when we were going to get a real copy of what it is we'll be voting on. So now I can't support that.
Other comments before we take a vote? Councilmember Price.
Does a vote for deferral imply acceptance of all these changes?
No. We're simply voting to defer.
We are deferring up to a definite point.
If the motion is to defer until the 24th.
I'd like to make an amendment, please. My motion for amendment.
You may make a motion.
I move that we have a subsequent meeting prior to the final reading that includes a total package of what we will be voting on.
Let me see if I've got this straight. We're going to be voting on the 24th, and that would be a final vote if it passes, but you're asking for a meeting after that?
No, I'm asking for
a work session.
Either a work session or a completed draft of what we will be voting on.
There will be, I will be calling a work session before the 24th. After we get a publication, which we hope this week. So okay, we need to look for a work session next week. It'll be toward the end of the week because I may be taking a winter vacation. So we have a motion that, and so you, that does not require a motion. I will be calling a work session.
No, my amendment is to have a completed draft prior to the deferral date.
I support that because we'll have a completed draft. No, we won't have a completed draft. No, I can't support that. We will have the, we will have the draft with the summary of changes. But we have a motion that we defer a vote until we have a final draft, which I'm not sure you all will support even then, but we'll have a final draft of this motion. So all, the motion is to defer until an indefinite date, until we have a revised, complete revised UDC with the changes proposed tonight. Any questions regarding the motion? Councilmember Dippolito.
Yes, Mr. Mayor, when might that occur? And Mr. Osweiler said you couldn't have it in 2 weeks, but when would that potentially be?
My sense is the work could occur in our office that following week, and that would set you up well if you chose to meet, for example, on March the 10th and have your final meeting, then you would have had the document about a week beforehand.
Any other questions regarding the motion to defer until a indefinite date, until there is a complete draft? We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All in favor of the motion, raise your hands. Councilmember Price, Councilmember Eichelhart, all opposed. That would be Diamond, Dippolito, and Wynn, and Orleans. The motion fails. We have a hand up. Yes, Councilmember Eichelhart.
Can I make the same motion, but for a specific day of 3:10?
Yes, we'll entertain that motion. A motion to defer. Now, if there's a specific date, would it be conditioned upon this the draft being available by a date certain?
Yes, but that's the reason.
So I need to have more of a motion.
If Mr. Intwell could give us a day that he'd be comfortable with to provide us with that clean copy.
So the motion would be to defer until the 10th, provided we have a completed copy of by a date certain, which would be
March 3rd.
March 3rd.
That's the motion.
Right. There's a motion to defer to March 10th, conditioned upon a complete revision based upon tonight's changes being available by March 3rd. Is there a second? We have a second by Councilmember Price. Any further discussion? Councilmember Diamond.
I believe March 10th is our drop dead date for the first reading expiration, and given the weather and all things that go on, I'm just not comfortable going to that absolute date. I'd like us to try, or, you know, I think a summary of changes in one place is not a lot to ask for, and if we need more time at that point, we have that option, but if we make it March 10th, we have no option.
So you're opposing the motion. Councilmember Dippolito.
Councilmember Diamond answered my question. I was wondering if there were any concerns about pushing it to the 10th. And my second question is, if we receive all the changes, we have a work session, then on the 24th, if we need additional time, can we defer again?
And I assume, yes, you can defer again, but as I understand from Councilmember Diamond, you couldn't defer it past the 10th.
You can't defer past the 10th.
But you can defer. We could have a special call tonight.
We still have questions about how the documents were written.
We can have, the council can have a special call meeting if we don't have a regular meeting coming up before the 10th.
Okay, thank you.
Any further discussion before we can vote on Councilmember Eichelhart's motion? All in favor of Councilmember Eichelhart's motion to defer to the 10th, raise your hands. Councilmember Price, Councilmember Eichelhart, in favor, all opposed. Councilmember Orleans, Wynn, DiPolito, and Diamond are opposed. That fails. All right, now we're going to be voting on the motion to defer until the 24th. Any further discussion on that? All in favor of deferring until the 24th, raise your hands. That's Diamond, DiPolito, Lynn, and Orleans, all opposed. Price and Eichelhart, motion to defer until the 24th. Go to work.
Ready for the next one, Mr. Mayor? Sorry,
yes.
And
you jumped right into it.
Since
bail out the city.
Well, since Councilmember Diamond's on a roll, I'm just going to let her take this one over to you. I'll take it. Never mind. She's up to this one. Approval of text amendments to the City of Roswell zoning ordinance required for the adoption of the UDC. This is the second reading presented by Mr. Townsend and then Mr. Davidson. Could you read the ordinance for us, please?
Thank you. This is an ordinance to amend the City of Roswell Code of Ordinances. The Code of Ordinances of the City of Roswell, Georgia is hereby amended to delete references to the zoning ordinance and refer to the Unified Development Code and shall read as follows. Text of which is incorporated here by reference and if approved, this will be the second reading.
All right. Is this part and parcel with the first motion? Has this been in front of the first motion?
Yes.
So so we would need to defer the reading of this to the 24th also?
Yes, sir. My motion was to defer this to coincide on the 24th with the UDC text.
Motion to defer on the 24th. Is there a second? Second by Councilmember Dippolito. Any further discussion? All in favor of the motion to defer to the 24th, raise your hands. Councilmember Orleans, Wynn, Dippolito, and Diamond, all opposed. Price, Councilmember Eichelhardt is abstaining, so that is deferred to the 24th. I believe we've covered everything other than the recommendation for closure to discuss personnel and real estate. Do we have a motion for closure?
So moved.
Motion by Councilmember Wynn. Is there a second? Second by Councilmember Dippolito. All in favor, raise your hands. That's passed unanimously. We're back to a unified council.
I've never seen it speak.